I want to welcome you all. I want to indicate that Trustees Livingston and Jerkowitz are not with us. Marty Bloom is not with us. So what you see is what you get. I also want to point out that today is the final meeting of Trustee Livingston and Jerkowitz and Mr. Luis Villegas, and I want to express my heartfelt thanks to each of them, two of them in absentia. I feel almost like doing a Clint Eastwood where I talk to the chair. But I'm going to refrain.
Should I get out of my chair?
But I mean, despite the obvious fact that we've had our differences, I think that we have all been in this for the benefit of the college, and that hard work needs to be acknowledged. And I look forward to a time when we can do that in, I believe we have a reception on December 5th for the outgoing trustees, and I'll make some further remarks at that point. We have item 1.4, which is the hearing of citizens, and I have no request to speak, so I'm assuming that we have plenty of citizens, but no hearing from. We move on to 1.5, recognitions, and Dan Watkins, I believe, is here to make a recognition of someone who has worked with us for a very long time.
Thank you very much. Good evening, President Gaskin, members of the board. Tonight, I'm honored and privileged to recognize Brandon Lovelace and his 15 years of service. I have a few highlights of things that he's done while at the college, as well as some lesser known facts about Brandon, and that'll be maybe a little surprise to him. And I just want to go over them. So it's fairly brief, but incredibly impactful to the institution. We have our server room, which is just across this room. It's our data center, and that build out and practically everything in there, Brandon has done. He's built out that data center, and there's over about 250 servers in that data center. Many of them have been consolidated and virtualized by Brandon's implementation of VMware. So that's come at significant savings to the college in both real dollars and power consumption. So by going towards building Santa Barbara City College's cloud infrastructure. He has also implemented our storage area networks, or SANs, which house all the data of all the important information about our college, our financial information, HR information, student information system information, all of the files we store on the network. He's been responsible for setting up that those storage devices, as well as setting up and implementing the backups. So all of our backups that go to the Wake Center, Brandon oversees and manages that. So, I mean, what he does for this college cannot be underestimated. I mean, it's just amazing. On top of that, he provides campus-wide email support. So every time GroupWise went down on the weekend or at night or when he was on vacation, we would call Brandon emails down, and he would do his best to get it back up while it wasn't on call. And finally, one of the things that he's been called upon a lot lately in the last year or so has been our Blackboard card swipe, keyless access. So he set up a lot of those. He tells me every day that it's not in his job description, and I say it's under the other duties as assigned. Mm-hmm. He did start his career in computer science working with Dean, and I know he's got a great relationship with the faculty and staff over in computer science. He spent his first 5 years there. A couple good things. You know how valuable someone is when something goes wrong, they go, where's Brandon? Let's call Brandon. Have we asked Brandon? So we're always trying to keep tabs on him, and luckily I have his personal cell phone, so I text him whenever something goes wrong to call on him. He does have at least another 30 years left at the college, which is really good because I'll retire 10 years before he leaves, so that's good for us. Some lesser-known facts is he's really into technical theater, setting up stages and managing stage productions, and he donates his time to the Santa Barbara City College Theater Group and helps them out with their productions. He also loves juggling and solving Rubik's Cubes. He's a Rubik's Cubes whiz. And surprisingly, he likes playing computer games. What techie person doesn't? So anyway, that's Brandon, and I am truly looking forward to working with him for at least the next 20 years I'm here.
My room is over there.
The colored tennis shoes that you typically wear, those bright things, as well as Brandon's absolute confidence in anything that's iPhone related. He's my go-to person. Sorry. The public doesn't hear that. But Brandon is incredibly
congratulations, Brandon. We'll see you here for the next 30 years. 30 years? That's okay. Item 1.6, minutes of the regular meeting, October 25th, 2012. Is there a motion to approve?
Second?
I seconded. Corrections or additions?
I have one.
Yes?
Top of page 4, there's a quote from me about clarifying the fact that the board did not spend $7 million in reserves. Mm-hmm. And I had brought that up because Trustee Livingston had blogged about this and talked about it at multiple meetings. But the part that needs, I think, to go in the minutes also is the fact that there was no board policy that was violated in moving the JPA monies from one fund bank account to another.
So specifically, what would you like to see?
I would like it to say after misinformation. In addition, no board policies were violated in this transaction, in the before referenced transaction.
Is there objection? Okay. So if the following vote of approval would reflect the change in the minutes, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Are there abstentions? None. The motion is approved by unanimous vote. We move on to item 1.7, communications, and report from the Academic Senate by Dr. Dean Nevins, who brings with him his trusty iPad.
Yes, not purchased at taxpayer expense, I'll have you know. President Haslund. Well, you know. President Haslund, members of the Board of Trustees, Superintendent President Gaskin. In the preceding 2 weeks, the Academic Senate met on October 24th and the 31st, mostly to rank 12 full-time faculty replacement positions. And unfortunately, we couldn't replace all 12. We had to replace only 7 of the 12. And the process is, we actually had 3 meetings. We met every week all October. And the department chairs send forward an application process with very specific information about it. I think you guys have a copy of that. They come and give a presentation, mostly to answer questions from the senators about, you know, what unique aspects of their program or whatever they mentioned inside their application packets. Then we rank according to, we usually use a method developed here on campus, actually. It's kind of a weighted ranking where you assign 1, 2, or 3 based on what you think the overall need of the college is. And they sum them up, and it's kind of a golf score thing. The lowest score gets it. And typically what happens is there's some pretty clear rankings at the top and at the bottom. Usually there's a couple in the middle, and we usually have to re-rank those, and that's what happened again this time. There were 2 positions that were very close together, and so we had to re-rank those. And so the 7 that actually were awarded were biological sciences. There were 2 positions. One was general biology and one was microbiology. There was radiographic technology, ADN nursing, chemistry, physics, and computer information systems. So those were the departments that actually get to replace a faculty member. Now, the other departments had very strong needs also. Every single person that came before us showed very clearly the damage that's going to be done to their department by not filling those positions. It's really unfortunate, but that's where we are with the budget. The departments that did not get a position were psychology, English, computer applications, English skills, and the School of Modern Languages, the Spanish position. So those were not awarded, and those departments are going to suffer because of it. It's very unfortunate. So are there any questions? For the senators, I would like to congratulate the senators for taking this incredibly seriously. Everybody reads everything. There were a couple people that couldn't make one of the presentations, and they listened to the audio, so everybody was caught up. So when we had our discussion, the discussions were clearly done by folks who had paid a lot of attention. They take it very, very seriously. It's the most important thing we do, I believe, the whole year. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dean. Geneva?
President Haslund, members of the board, Dr. Gaskin. We had one Senate meeting, so we haven't done too much since I last spoke to you, but we did attend General Assembly this past weekend, and that's when all of the Senates of all the community colleges get together and have one big meeting, and it was absolutely fantastic. I think we had a great time, and the new senators, as well as returning senators, I know personally I learned a lot, especially having to do with parliamentary procedures and all those super fun breakout sessions that we had, but it was very informational and really helped out our Senate a lot. So we had a good time, and then we did do a last push for Prop 30 that I think did pay off, and we were extremely happy about that. So I think we all are. And yes. And let's see, I spoke with Doss Williams' campaign managers, and he has agreed to come to our Senate meeting on November 30th. So if anyone, it's an open meeting, so if anyone wants to come to hear him speak to the Student Senate, he'll be there on November 30th at 9:00 in the morning. And I think that is all for today. Oh, we are having a Senate fundraiser tomorrow at Aldo's Italian Restaurant, which is on 1031 State Street on the corner of State Street and Figueroa, from 4:00 to 6:30. The percentage of the sales will be going to the Student Senate, so anyone and everyone in this room is welcome to bring family members, friends, anything, so we hope to see you there. Thank you.
Geneva, who's the beneficiary of these funds?
The Student Senate. It's one of our fundraisers that we're going to be doing.
So you use the money to?
It goes into our general fund, and then it goes primarily towards club grants. We give a lot of club grants during the year. And then we also have Senate activities that we do, such as tabling, and sometimes we need T-shirts, sometimes we need supplies for those. But most of our money goes towards clubs.
And what is the fee for going to this event?
Oh, it's just whatever, you just go and have dinner, and then a percentage of the sales that the restaurant gets during that time period, a percentage, I think it'll be 5 or 10%, goes towards our Student Senate.
Very good.
Yes, thank you very much.
Other questions? No, okay. Liz Auchincloss for classified employees.
President Haslund, members of the board, Dr. Gaskin. First of all, I want to congratulate the Student Senate. I've talked to one of their chaperones that went with them, and they were quite a, I think their actions spoke very well for the college. So I just wanted to mention that, since one of the people that I know went with them, and they did very well. It hasn't been too long, but our consultation group has met, and we are talked about the integrated planning work group, and we have members that are very interested in participating in the planning work group and in the mission statement group that we'll be meeting. So we have a lot of interest in that. And we're also talking about our structure and how it interacts between being empowered as a staff member, but also working in a structure that has a chain of command. So we're still grappling with that. And I also want to report that our CSEA negotiating team has come to a tentative agreement with the district that we'll be taking to our membership before the end of the month, so hopefully we can ratify everything, and you will ratify it, and we'll be on our way. That's it. Any questions?
No. Thank you. Before Dr. Gaskin starts, I'm remiss in not calling to your general attention a typo under item 9, closed session. It's followed by the word none, and then there are two items. So there will be a closed session, and we will take up two items. Dr. Gaskin?
Well, thank you very much. I have a few items to share with you. The first has to do with something that Liz just mentioned. We are embarking upon our mission statement reassessment and reevaluation process. And we have a consultant who's working with the institution who is highly regarded around the state. Her name is Dr. Eva Conrad, and she is former president at Moore Park College. And I had the opportunity to work with her through an accreditation process at another institution in Southern California. And what she is proposing and what has been accepted by CPC is that we go through a constituent-based process where we engage constituencies from Academic Senate, Student Senate, Dean's Council, EC, help me if I, consultation, Classified Consultation Group, the managers, the Board of Trustees. And we gather the thinking, the outlook, the perspective of all of those bodies relative to our mission and purpose. And so we'll be looking at doing an interview. We kind of like that model where we interview you as a body, and I'll be working with Dr. Haslund to schedule that. It will either be in December or in January, your study session. It'll be a half an hour interview. So again, all of these interviews then, the feedback from that will be compiled. We'll get some themes from that. CPC will have a retreat to which we will invite two board members at the appointment of the president of the board. We'll be engaging in that retreat in January and coming forth, we hope, with a revised mission statement. So that's part and parcel of the integrated planning that we're talking about, as well as reframing who we are as we go into the future. So that is mission statement. The second thing, and perhaps most notable, I've been walking around, I feel, with such better posture because I don't have the weight of further budget cuts on my shoulders as well as on the institution's shoulders. I texted somebody yesterday. I was walking across campus to buy something from the organic market, and I shared that it is a glorious day. Not only was it beautiful seeing our students walking around campus, I was on my way to an organic market on campus sponsored by students, but that Prop 30 had passed. And what it does is that it affirms the state's belief in what we do, our purpose, our mission, our scope. And for the first time after protracted budget reductions, for the first time this year, we are not going to have to absorb mid-year budget cuts to the tune of about $4.6 million at this institution. We won't have to further reduce course offerings across the spectrum of our courses. So what it means to Santa Barbara City College is phenomenal. It is quite impactful. And what we'll try and be able to do then is to serve the needs, the educational needs of our students who are pursuing transfer education, CTE, and basic skills. It will bring some additional revenue to the institution. And I will be turning to CPC to develop the recommendation on what our priorities are for that additional revenue, and you'll be seeing that. So it has been a very good week. Finally, I would like to share that I have not had the privilege of working with the three trustees who will be leaving us as long as you all have and as long as my colleagues at the institution have, and I'm actually quite saddened about that, because for the 4 months that I have had the honor, I've seen nothing but unwavering loyalty and dedication and fervent commitment to what it means to be a community college and in support of our community college students. So to the trustee who is here tonight, it is with sadness that I don't have the opportunity to work with you further, but I also have enjoyed learning from you and know that our college is so infinitely brighter and better because of your service, and I thank you. We are having a celebration.
Thank you.
Goes for Trustee Jerkowitz as well as Livingston as well. We are having a celebration, what day of the week, Wednesday? Wednesday, December 5th at 4:30 in the GDR, the Gourmet Dining Room. Looking over.
Excuse me, Dr. Gaskin, yes. As long as we're talking about Trustee Villegas, can you mention how many years you've served as a trustee?
A little over 19.
So I just thought that was important.
And I was going to do this. I was going to add the collective years, and it's a powerful number, and it represents a huge institutional history. I think close to around number 60 years, something like that. That's pretty phenomenal. And then you have your December calendar that Joan has ably put together. Well, thank you.
Well, I think we're all happy about the outcome of Proposition 30. I had the unique experience of thinking that nobody ever read the news press. Then I wrote a letter, and I actually had a phone call, one, not an avalanche, but just one, and he said that my argument worked. So that's I attribute one vote to that letter. See?
There was probably more.
I don't know. Okay, we move to item E, a report from board members, committee chairs. Are there any reports? No? I should report that we had a facilities committee meeting, and we were briefed on the progress of the humanities building, and it comes along very well. The considered opinion of virtually every aspect of the number of people who are working on this came to the realization that the lease-back approach that we've taken is working very well. We're on schedule, and we are not over budget in any significant way. So I found that meeting to be very productive.
Trustee Haslin, actually, I would like to make a report from fiscal.
Oh, that's good. I'm glad you did.
So generally, we meet on Mondays, and we chose to meet on Wednesday this week, the day after the election. And I just want to say I was just so honored to be a part of this committee and to know that regardless of the election result, the leadership of the college had done the hard work to give us two alternate budgets, whether the Prop 30 passed or not. So to be able to go into Election Day and then into the meeting the day after, knowing that even if Prop 30 hadn't passed, this Academic Senate, CPC, Business Services, and our president and interim president, Jack Friedlander, had done all the work necessary for us to transition calmly into whatever we needed to do. So I applaud you all. And that was the total agenda of our meeting, was to recognize where we're going next and to know it's taken care of. Thank you.
Okay. Anything on 1.8, reports, information? Move on to 1.9. Items for future board consideration. Dr. Gaskin wanted to talk about A and B.
Certainly. Thank you very much. And I want to frame these items for future board consideration. You may recall that we have added this onto our agenda as an opportunity for me to, if you will, give you a heads up on things that are coming down the line so that you have a sense about what we're working on. And most notably in A, I share the job description with you for the Center for Lifelong Learning Executive Director, not so much that you can take a look at the details as much as that you get a sense of where we're going with the position and that you realize how important we believe this position is, that we are bringing this to you now. Typically, we would not bring you a job description. We would bring it to you at the time of hire, when we hire the new position, we bring the new job description, and it's kind of all one package. But we know how much interest is out there in the Center for Lifelong Learning, and this has been a product of such a collaborative effort between the consultative group that is working with Dr. Friedlander and ably led by a cadre of community and institutional leaders. And they have worked probably for the last month on this job announcement. So it's been a labor of love. So I share this with you to let you know we will be embarking upon the national advertisement for this position. And we eagerly look forward to bringing him or her on board after the first of the year. So questions?
Questions on the job description? Just a comment. I think it's really a good idea to bring the job description to the board this early, because it gives us a chance to have a dialogue, if a dialogue, in fact, might be useful. Okay, item B.
I'd actually like to frame B and C. And B and C gives you a sense of where our thinking is relative to some critical reorganization needs we have at the institution. And while this is not set in concrete, it is actually two sets of very dynamic documents. It does give you a flavor for two critical areas, human resources, actually three, emergency preparedness, and Joe's area in administrative services. We have some deficiencies, we have some holes, and we have some gaps. And what we're trying to do is deploy our resources in such a way that we can fill those gaps. So with human resources, probably the most significant aspect of this is that I will be recommending that we not replace the Vice President of Human Resources and Legal Affairs. Rather, we solidify the interim position that Pat English is filling into a Vice President of Human Resources. Through reorganization, we provide that position on a permanent basis as an assignment to Pat, that we not refill the position she was an incumbent in, Director of HR, and we utilize the savings to deploy it in different ways. One little way is to provide a reclassification in her area to assist her, as well as to redeploy then the bulk of that funding to high priority areas. I'm not convinced, after my colleagues shared very thoughtful remarks with me at CPC, I'm not convinced that the direction we will take is the one that's written on this paper. But I will tell you, and I will tell the institution, I'm pretty fervent about ensuring that we are ready in a disaster and an emergency, and that we are properly trained. I'm working with Joe right now, based upon feedback we received at CPC this week, on some alternative scheme for how we address that at the highest level. And I feel quite confident that my standards and expectations, and your standards and expectations, will be met. It's one of your goals for emergency preparedness and response. So we will not let you down, but we may be doing it in a slightly different way. So while not necessarily needing to get into the details, I am here to answer any questions you might have. What remains, though, is the commitment to restructuring HR slightly so that we can accrue a cost savings, salary savings, redeploy that in another way. And there are certainly needs across this institution.
Questions? Marcia?
Is there a broad time frame that you have in mind?
Yes. We would like to do this by the first of the year. And I'm looking to Joe. I think that's now our two reorganizations are becoming inextricably linked because we have some thinking that may overlap between the two. So, yeah, and you'll see all of that through the hiring process and new job descriptions. So, Joe, do you want to comment then on your reorganization? Could we flow into C?
Sure. Sure.
I want to watch Joe flow.
That's not on TV, right?
Basically, I just want to reaffirm what Dr. Gaskin has said, that we are working now on how we're going to do it, and it is going to be a little bit different model than what we presented, but I think a very good one. I think that we are going to be able to realize considerable savings by not replacing the director of risk management position, but we have found ways to take those responsibilities and reassign them with resources that we have and use some of that funding, as you'll see, to support what we need to do in those areas. But basically, realize the budget savings that we've had to in the past, take into account, because we have had serious reductions here. We have had looked at how we can get those savings in place, and this helps us retain that. And so you'll see, I think, a very complete plan at the December 13th board meeting, we hope.
Thank you. Item D, you wanted to take D and E together, or?
No, I can take them separately.
Okay.
D. At your June 20th meeting, you directed the institution to convert 40% of the non-enhanced, non-credit courses in continuing ed to fee-based for fall, and then an additional 20% in winter quarter. And we have done that. We have reached that target. What we left undetermined was spring quarter. And the CE division has been having dialogue about that, obviously, because we need to begin programming. And that dialogue continued at CPC a couple of meetings ago. CPC, rightly so, was reluctant to proffer a recommendation to me and to you, absent the outcome of Prop 30. Now that we know the outcome, we will be bringing it back to CPC on November 20th, I believe that's the next meeting, and then we'll be coming forth with a recommendation at your December. We may have to take action on December 6th, which is a study session. So I just wanted to let you know we have not forgotten about it, and you will be seeing that.
One question. I'm assuming that the dialogue includes the Continuing Education Consultation Council?
Oh, yes. That's where the recommendation emanated.
Okay.
To CPC.
Yeah.
Questions? Okay. Item E.
It is incumbent upon me to update you regularly on what we're doing with our accreditation status and the sanction that we have of warning. And while you may have heard silence for the past month and a half, it's been anything but silent in our committee work that has a very vibrant committee comprised of Dean and Liz and Allison and Robert Else and Peter and Joel and myself. So pretty much the highest level of leadership across the institution. And we are taking our role very, very seriously. This is in preparation for the special report that must be submitted to ACCJC by March 15th. So it's out of ordinary. It's not at all routine. And we have chosen to approach it as a mini self-study of Standard 4. We have conducted an institution-wide survey, and that survey will be accompanied by a report that speaks to all of the sections of Standard 4. And our assessment of that. We have interviewed you, we've interviewed other groups on campus, and we have our first draft, and we're going through our first draft of that report. The more solidified draft will be sent to CPC on December 4th, and they will have two readings. It will come to you for two readings. In February, we will submit in March. So that's what's happening there, and we hope to step up to the concerns and the issues that were brought forward by ACCJC and address those areas that the commission has felt that we are not meeting the standard. And I turn to my colleagues, Joel, Peter, those out in the audience, if there's any additional comment you would like to make about the process we're engaged in.
Well, I could say that I've worked under some tough taskmasters in the past, but yeah. None quite like the present. And I will be glad when the process is over.
Yeah. This has been, let's say it's something that I'm really joyful to have been part of, but when it's over, I don't want records or comments or T-shirts or I'll just be glad it's over. That'll be my celebration as it is, because it was not easy. It was.
I'm taking them all out to dinner. Yeah. It's a really hard job, and everyone is taking it so seriously. This is really, really hard. And because I've had such experience with accreditation, that's what we're referring to. We just had a really deep meeting. And it's tough. It's really tough. Dinner is the least I can do.
I would concur. We move on to item two, because I've promised my friend and colleague, Luis Villegas, that we'll get out of here in time for dinner. Item 2.1 is going to represent a difficult choice for us, because, as you recall, we were unable to complete this task at our last meeting and because the forms that were submitted were incomplete. They have now been completed, and so we have two tasks before us. One is the appointment of Charles Plo as representative of the Taxpayers Association, and the second is to select two of the remaining three, Joseph Bailey, Sally Green, and Bernice James, as representatives of the community at large. We can only appoint two. Joe Bailey and Sally Green are the incumbents, and they are asking for a second year. Bernice James is new to this process, but certainly not new to Santa Barbara. So I would have difficulty here, and but I submit that what we should do first is to move for the approval of Charles Plo as the representative of the Taxpayers Association. Is there such a motion? Moved. Second?
Second.
Is there discussion of the nominee? Hearing none, we move for approval. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Hearing none, the motion passes. Is there a motion to select two of the following three as our selectees? Or do you want to have a show of hands for each of the three just to see how we?
That might be simpler.
That might be simpler. Well, maybe what I'll do is take a motion to approve one of the three, and we will see if that passes.
Trustee Villegas, you have a better idea on how to handle this recommendation?
Probably the easiest would be to what Dr. Haslin just mentioned is one by one in a show of hands and majority wins, right? Takes the two top vote getters, take the
okay.
The positions. I think that would be easiest and
okay.
Quickest.
Then as I call out the name, if you will raise your hand, and I will raise my hand. And Angie, if you'll count, this is okay. Going to be a major task. So first, Joe Bailey, Sally Green, Bernice James. Well, I think we have a majority. What do you take to be the... Sally and Bernice are selected.
Can you take action?
We can take action. Is there a motion to approve Sally Green and Bernice James?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Motion is carried unanimously. With thanks to Joe Bailey for having served a year in this position. Difficult decision. All right, we move on to item three, Superintendent President. Do we have anything?
Mine's at the end.
Oh, that's true.
Yes.
Four, Human Resources, Legal Affairs, Pat English.
Good afternoon, members of the board and Dr. Gaskin. I am here to present Human Resources Consent Agenda Items 4.1 through 4.5. I don't have any changes to make, so I'm happy to submit them all at once for your consideration.
Is there a motion to approve? Motion is made. Is there a second?
Second.
Second for Luis. Discussion of any item? Hearing none, we move to a vote. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion is carried. There are no abstentions, I take it. Okay, good. Item five, thank you very much, Pat. That was neat, clean, and fast. I'm gonna move this right along. Educational programs, Jack Friedlander.
And in for him is Betty Pazit.
I was gonna say, you don't really look much like Jack Friedlander.
Good afternoon, President Haslin, members of the board, and
and our president. I'm here honored to be a stand-in for Dr. Friedlander and submit to you item 5.1, the co-curricular budget for 2012-13, which you will note we are very fortunate that our bookstore is committing an increased contribution, which we're delighted and very fortunate to have.
Is there a motion to approve the budget? Okay, we drop it and move on. We, just, we have a motion to approve. Okay, you're going to make me work for this. I need a second for the motion. Second. Discussion of the budget?
I have a question.
Yes.
I noticed that the bookstore contribution has significantly increased. And my question is, obviously, my sense of it is that the bookstore profits have been dropping a little for various reasons. I mean, not for lack of doing really well in terms of our economy. But my question has to do with, does some other area that has traditionally received money from the bookstore get less when we increase this? It would seem that way. Joe, can you comment?
He should come up.
Wireless mics up there.
As a separate enterprise fund, what ends up at the end of the year that's unallocated falls to their ending balances and is held in their ending balances. And so this just, and I haven't looked at it to see what the actual impact is, but that would reduce the amount, assuming all of the things constant, that would go to ending balances. And they have currently, I believe just a little over $5 million held in their ending balances, which is in their capital funds and in their assets. And so it would reduce the amount allocated to that possibly. But again, I haven't looked at it in detail this year. And I do believe that they're running pretty constant on their contributions the last few years. They might have gone down slightly, but not significantly.
No, I was really comparing it more to, I think most of that $5 million is in assets, correct? It's not in cash, and I'm assuming this is cash that we're transferring.
I believe about half of it's in assets and half's in cash when I looked at it.
Okay.
Okay. We have a motion on the floor. Are you prepared to vote? Mm-hmm. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Thank you.
Okay, item 5.2 are the course modifications and removal of course plus hours from our curriculum advisory committee.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second? Okay. Discussion? We all know what this is about. We're simply being in compliance. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? None. Thank you very much, Betty. Move on to item 6, continuing education.
We have Amisha.
Okay. Welcome.
President Gaskin and Dr. Haslin and Board of Trustees, I'm here to stand in for Dr. Ariana for 6.1 to ask for approval of new fee-based courses in continuing education.
Motion to approve. Motion is made. Second. Is there discussion of the motion? Hearing none, we move to a vote. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Motion is carried unanimously.
And 6.2 for approval of state-funded courses and certificates in continuing education.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Elise moves. Second? Okay, second. Thank you. Discussion of the motion? Hearing none, we move to a vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Motion is carried. It may seem to everybody that we're really not spending a lot of time on each item. The fact is we have read and digested each item and come prepared to move and go along. We move to item 7, Joe Sullivan for Business Services.
And I would offer our business consent item 7.1 for your consideration.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Motion's made. Second?
Second.
All right. Is there discussion of any item? Yes.
One question. The trust accounts under C, I notice we're establishing a trust account for private loans. And my question is, if private loans are not repaid, does the college have any liability for that?
The college would not have any liability for loans made from that fund, no.
Okay.
Okay. Is that satisfactory? Mm-hmm. Other comments, questions of Joe?
That item stood out for me, too, but it's just great that there's money available, I'm assuming, for small loans for students who
emergency need loans.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. So great.
Good. I sense we're ready to vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? None. Motion carries.
Okay, then item 7.2A and 7.2B can be taken together, the budget transfers for major objects and the augmentations to revenue.
These are resolutions 20 and 21.
Yes.
Is there a motion to approve? Motion's made. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there discussion? Hearing none, we move to a vote.
Trustee McGrundy?
Aye.
Trustee Cronister?
Aye.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Aye.
Trustee Diego.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
We move to a closed session, and I don't anticipate that it will be a long closed session, but I would submit that it is, 15 minutes, 20 minutes?
Probably about 20.
Okay. Let's see if we can do it in 20 minutes. We stand adjourned until we reconvene. Closed session, and there's no reportable action taken. We move on to our final item 10, Superintendent President.
Yes, presented for your consideration is a recommendation to delegate authority to appoint a hearing officer for disciplinary action case 2012-100, and that you would delegate that authority to me.
Is there a motion to that effect? Motion is made. Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, we move to a vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Motion is carried. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Oh, we all moved.
Just, I don't know if we did this before, but I don't believe we did, but if we could adjourn this meeting in the memory of John Diaz, a longtime employee.
And I would like to honor our three trustees, long-term trustees as well.
Very good.
Thank you, Luis.
Thank you.
I think Joan and Maury.
That's a wonderful, wonderful suggestion. Thank you. We then adjourn this meeting in honor of John Diaz, as well as our three departing trustees. Okay, motion has, I don't need a motion. We have a motion. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay. I'm so glad. Meeting is adjourned.